This evening on The Rock Newman Show, Black Economics Today, Dr. Claud Anderson discusses his new book, A Black History Reader, 101 Questions You Never Thought to Ask. He'll break down how recent political moves on taxes, judge appointments, and healthcare laws will impact the black community economically. That's coming up right now on The Rock Newman Show. Welcome to The Rock Newman Show from the campus of historic Howard University, located in the nation's capital. I'm Rock Newman, and it is my desire to inspire you with personal stories of extraordinary achievement. Dr. Claud Anderson's new book, A Black History Reader, is laid out in a question and answer format. It begins with this quote: "The social construct on race was deliberate and permanent. It is so fundamental to the issue of race that the topic cannot be considered in any serious way without understanding it. It is therefore the first question in this book." Welcome. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you, Rock, for inviting me back.
This is this book, this book, A Black History Reader, 101 Questions You Never Thought to Ask. I'll tell you what I did. I tore out the table of contents. In my estimation, this book is so extraordinarily comprehensive when it examines the issue of blacks in this country from the beginning of time of this country until now, that it's almost as if, I've got to stay away from thinking any one thing is a panacea. But this book right here is, I'll be corny, is the bomb.com. Let me just start here. So the Black History Reader, 101 Questions You Thought You'd Never Ask, You Never Thought to Ask, provides answers and solutions to how and why black people have been consigned to the lowest level of America's ranking order of social and economic acceptability. Now, when I read that, I was like, well, boy, that's a very broad statement. That's a tall order. That's a high challenge there. Then I read the book, and it was like, it absolutely provides answers and solutions. I want people to be aware of this book. I want folks to be aware. Now, it says today, America finds itself embroiled in issues of the Confederacy, slavery, immigration, and a myriad of issues based on race and racism. And it asks the question, why is race such an enduring problem? And your answer is?
For the simple fact that it's the third rail in American society. Nobody wants to touch it. Because see, if they touch it, all of a sudden that obligates white folk to do something in response to the fact that they have maltreated black folk throughout 500 years in this country. And they systematically maldistribute almost 100% of all this nation's resources. That's all the land, wealth, power, resource, privileges, rights, and controls of all levels of government into the hands of the dominant white society. And they've been locked and boxed into that, and now they're presently a permanent underclass. And whites don't want you to bring that up, because that way they have some obligation. And so what they'll do, they'll push back and say, we're not planning on sharing anything with black folk in this country. And that's the dilemma. Nobody wants to address the issues of what they do. They just try to use very broad, ambiguous terms to make black folk disappear and become unnecessary and irrelevant in this society.
You know, I'm going to go past the question of how is it that blacks are always on the bottom. I'm going to go past that, because in your answer there, you to a certain extent, you just answered that question.
That's right. See, that 98, 99.5% of everything of value in the country was maldistributed into everybody's hand except black folk. Black folk have been locked into only one half or 1% of anything of value of this country now for over 460 years. It is impossible, Rock, in comparative and theoretical terms, for blacks to be a competitive people. Can't be done. You can't make it off of 0.5% in a nation that is it is a competitive society where people are competing. It can't compete. What are they going to compete with?
You ask the probing question. How is it that black civil rights, the black civil rights era, produced more gains for other class groups than the intended beneficiary, blacks?
For a very simple reason, and that is through inherited wealth. I just told you a few minutes ago that 99% of everything was maldistributed into the hands of the dominant white society, but now 87% of it's frozen, locked in there. It's locked into the dominant white society, into their trust accounts, banks, institutions, universities, communities, and their culture. Black folk cannot get access to it. That's why the present administration, like with Trump, one of the first things they're going to focus on is inherited laws, change the tax structure, so they can pass on all these rights and benefits into their offsprings. And black folk, on the other hand, are going to be confronted by white kids, for instance, a white child gets 87% of what he needs to be a competitive individual in our society at birth. As soon as he hits the air in a hospital, he gets 87% because everything he needs is in the white society. He can get access to it anytime he wants. But the black child, on the other hand, he can't compete because when he's born in that same hospital, there's nothing inheritable that he can gain. So because everything that the blacks have been focusing on for the last 100 years is non-inheritable. Food stamps, welfare, public housing, and a job, you cannot inherit them. So the black child is non-competitive. He can't compete with a white child. So in the morning, even if he wants a job, he got to dress up and go to a white neighborhood or somebody else's neighborhood and try to look for a job. It's impossible. He can't compete. That's why he's a permanent underclass.
You say permanent underclass, which begs the question, is there any hope that the issue of race will ever be resolved in this country?
I think there's a very, very slight chance that it can be resolved. But it's going to be up to black folks to do it, though. See, because they're going to be pushed back from the dominant society because they got a social construct that excludes black folk. And so later on, you can ask me about it. The key is going to be how black folk classify themselves. See, first of all, black folk got to classify themselves as native blacks to make sure there's a distinct difference between a black coming from Africa and a black coming from the Caribbean, native blacks. That means people that were born and raised in this country 400 or 500 years ago, mm-hmm. that are peculiar to this, that's it. And if you focus on that, then say, now, what is special about those native blacks? Then you have to say, they are exceptional people. Black people in America are exceptional, they are special people. Now, we have politicians running around the country every day talking about America is an exceptional nation. And because America is a exceptional nation, based on the fact that they have a democracy, so be the cradle of democracy, and that they have most liberal immigration policies, and that people can vote and do all these kind of things. So they said, therefore, the American political entity is supposed to be an exception, and therefore they should be given special favors among all the nations of the world. What I say is that if that's true, then black people in America are exceptional people. They're an exception within an exception, because see, nobody's been treated like black folk. You keep talking about this is a land of immigrants, and see, but black folk are only non-immigrants. You can't keep bringing immigrants into the country over black folk and giving them special benefits in that terms. That's why blacks can't compete. And can I take about a minute to get these points out for you?
Yeah.
See, there are four or five things. They're right now debating the DACA immigration law.
Sure.
That's going to be the death knell of black folk. That's going to be the nail in the coffin for black folk. Because, see, this nation set up its first immigration laws in 1790. It says this is an immigrant nation, and any people of the world that can pass for or look like whites can come here and get special benefits, Rock. They can come here and get them, but the only people that can't get it are black folk. And everybody was invited to come here, and they maldistributed all the resources. And they started out by putting most of the resources, starting with the land, which blacks couldn't get. But let me go back to this.
Can I stop you just for 1 second?
Sure, uh-huh.
Because I want you to take that further.
Okay.
So, most progressives, to use that term, when they look at the policies of this particular administration that's in power right now, mm-hmm. Republicans control the White House, the Senate, and the Congress, and you talk about DACA, the sense is that most progressives, most black folks, want to do, quote unquote, the humane thing and make sure that those that are born here have rights and are not exported, and their parents aren't put out of the country. So are you on the other side of that argument?
No. What I'm saying is that to do that, it is unjustifiable. It's illegal and unconstitutional, and it's the worst form of injustice that you commit against black folk. Because what you're violating is black folks' rights. Mm. But see, you cannot, the 13th Amendment, let's go back for a second. The 13th Amendment came into existence after the Civil War. Yeah. It says very clearly, Rod, that it mandates that black folk be treated in all manners similar to whites in this nation. Mm-hmm. Now, but immigration policies and bringing in immigrants only negatively impact black folk. Mm-hmm. It's not impacting anybody else. Mm-hmm. Black folk are the only injured parties by immigration. Mm-hmm. Then you go to the 14th Amendment. The 14th Amendment says that black, and remember the 13th, 14th, 15th Amendment, those things were written for black folk, that black folk must have due process and equal protection under law. Mm-hmm. If black folk are the only people being negatively impacted by immigrants, you're violating their 14th Amendment. Mm-hmm. There should be all kind of lawsuits right now raised by black folk. Mm-hmm. And then the Civil Rights Law of 1865 and 1866 said very specifically, Rock, that every level of government is mandated to use all necessary means to lift the badges and incidents of slavery off the shoulders of black folk. Mm-hmm. Now, here you are bringing in all these immigrants over black folk. Mm-hmm. And here's what you do when you bring them all into black folk. Because you do the same thing they were doing in 1790 when they brought in all these immigrants. Mm-hmm. You bring in millions of immigrants over black folk from Europe, Eastern Europe, Western Europe, Northern Europe, mm-hmm. and you brought them in over black folk. When you bring in immigrants, here's what happens. You got black folk that are branded. They don't get any benefits for being living in this country because they're branded as being slaves. They get zero benefits. Now, they're not immigrants. Now, watch what on the other side. Now, when immigrants come in, watch the benefits they get. They go past black folk at 200 miles an hour to pass them. That's why in all these cities, in Chocolate City, they do better right here in Chocolate City. Now, they're underneath the immigrants. Immigrants, they come in the country, they get a point over black folk for being an immigrant. Blacks are the only non-immigrant. Two, all of them are classified as whites. The Arabs, Asian, Hispanics, they've all been reclassified as whites. Even American Indians back in the 1890s became classified as whites. They get a point. That's the second point. They get over black folk in getting access to resources and benefits. The third thing they get the benefits for being put into a minority category. Mm-hmm. They're classified as minorities over black folk. Thirdly, they come in with a culture that they can establish a culture that they can now build businesses and industries and relate back to their homeland. And lastly, what they can do, they also bring in a religious aspect and business opportunities for their people. Black folk get nothing, and they can come in and take and dominate black folk. That's why right now black folk have been buried as an underclass. That's why in this Black Labor, Black History Reader, you look at the second question. It'll show you that the last statistics that came out from the United States Department of Labor says that everybody's over black folk. Black folk have not moved one iota in 150 years. They're still on the bottom, underneath the society and outside of it.
You said something earlier in an answer where you said that you talk about native blacks. And so that clearly sounds as if you are delineating native blacks versus someone that comes here from Bermuda or Jamaica or wherever they may come from. That is black.
That's right.
And the purpose of that is what? Because you're on the surface, it would be like, hey, everybody here that's black gets treated a certain way. Why are you making that delineation?
That is an excellent point. You know why? Because you see, those people coming in from Jamaica or coming in from Africa, they have not been treated like black folk in this country. That's the first thing. And secondly,
historically,
they haven't had those historical experiences. They come in here voluntarily. When they come in here, they bring some cultural aspects from Africa. They can go back anytime they want. But the black people in this country are exceptional people. Nobody's been mistreated and maltreated like them. Black folk are exceptional. They're the only people that came here forcefully, one. Two, they're the only people that denied their humanity. Three, they were the only people denied a right to enjoy the fruits of their labor. Four, they were the only people denied the right to participate in government. Five, they were the only people denied the right to vote. Six, they were the only people denied the right to have an education. Seven, they were not the only people denied the right to have a business. Eight, they were the only people that participated in every war that this country has had since its founding, but whose mother country has never been against this country. All those immigrants come from countries where they fought America, and they came in. And seven, that they are the oldest and most patriotic people in the country. Not the Confederates in the South. They're not the most patriotic people waving the Confederate flag. The most patriotic people in this country are black people, native blacks, because you see 99% of all those blacks have been direct descendants of slaves. They've been here before 99% of all the other people ever arrived in this country. They are special people. And because they are special people, they need to be recognized, appreciated, and reparated for what they've done in this country and building this country. They're the ones that built the bridges, the roads, cut the timber, the trees, cleared the land, raised the tobacco, cotton, indigo. They're the people that fought to raise in every war to protect this country. Those, the people coming from Africa or coming from Jamaica didn't. They came here voluntarily. And the most important point on this is if you lump them with black folk, then you give the dominant white society a justification to say we don't owe black folk anything. Mm-hmm. Because you see, the blackness that this native, the blackness, black people's blackness is more than just color. It is their heritage, it's their history, yeah. It's their code of conduct, and more importantly, it is their badge of honor, and it's what it symbolizes the indebtedness that this country has to them. This country does not have an indebtedness to people coming from Africa. Mm-hmm. They only have an indebtedness to people coming in from the Bahamas. Mm-hmm. If you lump black folk in there, you deprive black folk of the benefit, the debt that's owed them. Don't do that.
Whew, you are spitting fire. Let's keep going here. And I want to deal with some of the historical aspects of all of what you're talking about. Okay. But you know, something that is what is 50-year history, for example, is Martin Luther King's colorblind dream. Did his and the civil rights movements focus on integration and having the ability to sit at the counter with the dominant society and open up a lot of doors where there was obviously very clear legalized discrimination to knock down those barriers? Did that take the focus off of blacks' rights?
Yes, it did. Yes, it did. And let me go back before you get to the back of what Martin Luther picked up. And see, and again, Martin Luther King and the civil rights leader, they did the best they could at that particular time, uh-huh. You know, what they thought was right, but they didn't look far enough down the road,
right.
And they got bamboozled and tricked. Because you see, the initial decision and the suit that was filed for what you all might call social integration, the civil rights movement, was filed in McClinton, South Carolina. And what those black folk filed for, they filed for desegregation. And what desegregation means, we don't have the what Anderson talks about. We don't control those resources. We don't have any resources. And so what was happening in McClinton, South Carolina, back in 1948, when that lawsuit was filed, those black kids were walking to school and up dirt road in the rain and snow trying to get to school. They when they got to school, they didn't have the same privileges in those schools like in North Carolina. I was from South Carolina, North Carolina, where we spent the first week of school every year cleaning up old textbooks, old materials, and used stuff that was coming from the white schools. Yeah. Whites got all the new materials. They got all the fabrics and the tools, the machinery, technology. We got the used, broken down, and they had to fix it up. Spend the first week of school with big erasers, cleaning up the books and putting tape on them. The white kids had swimming pools in their schools. We didn't have swimming pools. We used to have to go down the dam up the creek to swim. And so the white kids rode the buses. We walked. And the worst part about it, that the state was giving something like about $12 for every white child to go to school, but only $1.50 for a black child to go to school. Mm-hmm. What the McClinton, South Carolina people were saying is that we won't have equal control of the resources that you began to maldistribute in the 1790s to everybody but us. We won't have our fair share of it. Mm-hmm. And so when it went to the courts, and it wound up going to the Supreme Court by 1954. At that point, what black folk wanted was to have equal treatment. Blacks had miraculously acquired a lot of communities. Mm-hmm. They had bars, white professional football teams, baseball teams. Mm-hmm. We had a lot. We had our own business.
Land.
land.
Lots of land.
We had some land there.
Yeah.
By 1920, black folk had acquired about 20 million acres of land in this country that they had to buy. White folks didn't buy their land. They got it free on land grants. And so when Martin Luther came along, what he says is that now, what NAACP triggered it by simply saying, the best thing we can do for blacks in this country is to eradicate anything that reflects blackness. Let's move now to, let's sanitize everything. Let's get rid of all aspects of blackness. That means, so they changed it to social integration. Social integration is a weakening process. But if I start putting cream in a coffee, I'm not making the coffee any stronger, I'm weakening it. Right. If I put water in gasoline, I'm weakening it. So when Martin Luther came in, he picked it up and he started saying, what we want is to show white folk that we are acceptable, that we can be, and to take the focus off our blackness. And when that started and they were successful, then the black leadership gave up and say, hey, we can't do anymore, so we'll just go with what we call benign neglect and political correctness, which make black folk disappear. And that way nobody has to focus on the black issues anymore. And when Martin Luther took the focus off of black folk and put it on socially disadvantaged, then it was twisted over and merged into and morphed into what you call political correctness for everybody. And so therefore they corrupted and distorted the 13th Amendment, the 14th Amendment, the 15th Amendment, those civil rights laws. Those laws were written specifically and solely for black people. And that all these immigrants have no rights. There's no justification for it.
Okay, so you know, we certainly have the luxury of hindsight now, and doing not Monday morning quarterbacking, but 50 years later quarterbacking. You know, so what should have been the focus to achieve a status for black folks that would have prevented 50 years later, there being a permanent underclass?
Oh, Rock, you just asked, you always ask some beautiful questions. That's right on target. Now, what they should have done at the civil rights movement, say, first, before we do anything, before we start talking about social integration, let's go back and identify what was the primary purpose of slavery. What was the primary purpose?
Yeah.
The primary purpose of slavery was to classify blacks, strip them of their humanity, and to make them, classify them as 3/5 of a human being, and classify them as property.
Yeah.
And it started with property, that anybody can own them, they'd be no different from any other property.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why George Washington says that starting this new nation, their wealth would be embedded, starting first with land. And so George Washington say in that case, owning property. George Washington says, so give me 100,000 acres of free land. Thomas Jefferson said, if you give him 100,000 acres of free land, give me 100,000 acres of free land.
Mm-hmm.
Patrick Henry says, I want 65,000 acres of free land. Every white immigrant coming to the country could pick up 650 acres of free land, free. And then they get another 150 acres for every slave he owned. And then the bottom line, the railroads picked up something like about 24 million acres of free land across the nation. Everybody got free land except black folk. Mm-hmm. And if you
just stop there, the basis for building foundational wealth
is in land. And blacks couldn't even get 40 acres of land.
Yeah.
Blacks couldn't get, I'd get free land because land was property and blacks were classified as property.
Yeah.
So they passed things like fugitive slave laws saying you are property, you're no different from the land. And they set up a thing called the American Dream that you hear all these politicians. The American Dream was anybody coming from any place around the world, from in the Middle East, from Asia, Africa, could come into America and they can get what's called the American Dream.
Yeah.
They're still doing it right now. That's what the DACA is. They're coming to this country looking for, and the DACA, the American Dream is unearned benefits. Slavery was unearned benefits. So they come to this country right now getting unearned benefits, but black folk can't get them. And that's how they go right past black folk. And it's illegal, unconstitutional, but nobody's raised that issue in all these discussions about immigration. Nobody says that black folk are being negatively impacted. They got all these programs for immigrants.
Yeah.
When they go around and say, we're gonna give immigrants social security, welfare, public housing, all stuff, but you don't give it to black folk.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I don't think we fully completed as your idea of what the civil rights, what should have been happening in the civil rights movement.
Let me go back to that.
Mm-hmm.
So what the first thing they should have done was say, what we first want to do is go back and correct the purpose and address the purpose of slavery.
Mm-hmm.
What was the purpose of slavery?
Mm-hmm.
The purpose of slavery was to handicap a specific a group of people and handicap them and hold them while we provide benefits to everybody else. So what they first thing they should have done is say, if this nation is maldistributed, 100% of all the land, resource, businesses, income, privileges, rights, and controls of a government to the white society. That's the first thing we must address. We must go back and look at that and address it. And they didn't never did that, even when it came out of slavery. That there was no wealth, blacks had no wealth. White, the average white person coming out at the beginning of, end of slavery had 3,500 times more wealth than blacks.
Yeah.
Black folk had never owned and controlled anything greater than 0.5% or 1%. That means that in present terms, Rock, even today, that hasn't changed since slavery, that the right now in this country, we got something like about 500 to 600 white billionaires. We got over 500 to 600 white billionaires in this country. And two or three of them has more wealth than all 44 million black folk put together. Black folk can't compete, they don't own the control and the wealth. Everything from Boston to San Diego, California, all the land, resources, business, trucks, airlines, anything you name, it belongs to whites. Blacks own and control zero. That's why right now, 38% of the black folk in America are beneath the poverty line. You got about another third sitting right on the poverty line if they lose their house and their car. And they can't compete. As a matter of fact, if black folk own such a small amount of wealth in this country, and if whites were to stop in racism tomorrow, then it would take black folk another 238 years to catch up with where white folk are today in terms of wealth ownership. Two white men right now own more wealth than all 44 million black folk. How can you compete in a society where you own and control nothing? And the only thing they're giving you is things that are non-inheritable. And it's like a real life monopoly game. If you don't own and control the land going around the board, you can't own the water company or the railroads, you own nothing. You're gonna either go bankrupt or you're going to jail.
You know, you've mentioned different times here, you're even talking about, going into the schools, what you did for the first week or whatever it was, was to clean up the old books that you got from, were hand-me-downs. And
right.
I went to a segregated elementary school. And
you
I
did?
Yeah, absolutely. And I remember that we had the books that had come down from the school just up the street from where we were.
See, that's not right, Doc. Rock.
So, you know, it felt as if there was a foundation at this all-black elementary school that was trying to lift us up with education. So the question is, has education been a equalizer for blacks?
No. It's been an equalizer for everybody but black folk. And the amazing part about that is that black folk right now hold the greatest academic achievement on the earth. See, we're all doing slavery for 360 years, and I never hear anybody talk about this on the Fox channels or these white redneck conservatives say this. But the problem is that in this country, they talk about how ignorant black folk are. They never say that, yes, if black folk are ignorant, it was imposed ignorance that was imposed on them.
Mm-hmm.
For 360 years, it was against the law, Rock, to be caught teaching a black person to read and write.
Yeah.
It'll cost you 39 lashes and $100 to teach a black person to read and write. And that was all the way up to the 1860s. That so in 1860, when blacks came out of slavery, you got to understand 96% of black folk in America could not read and write. But guess what? The immigrants coming into the country, the white people class, white immigrants coming to the country, they had a 96% ignorant rate too, illiteracy rate. And so, but between 1865 and 1895, black folk reduced their illiteracy rate from almost 196% all the way down to 47%.
Mm-hmm.
And they did it by themselves, basically. They hold a record of achievement. Nobody in the history of the world has ever come out of slavery and be able to reduce their illiteracy rate by in half in 30-year time period. But what happened, the reason that it didn't benefit black folk, that by 1950, as an example, black folk never got the benefits of getting an education. There were no benefits to track their educational achievement. That's why white teachers were making twice to three times more than a black teacher in the 1950s. In the 1950s, a black person, a black teacher with a college education and a law and teaching degree, he could only earn 50% of half of what a white high school dropout was earning.
Mm-hmm.
Because the benefits for education never followed black folk. That's why right now I got all these black folk going to school, Howard University and all the rest of the universities, coming out with master's degrees, but they don't master anything. They got a master's degree but master nothing. And I see half of them working at McDonald's and Burger King and Wendy's with college degrees because they don't have a community, they have no wealth base, they have no businesses. So they're still dependent on other people to use their education. And to use their education, the white society puts the value of that education. You can have a doctor's degree, but I'm gonna pay you what I wanna pay you because you have no place else to use it. And consequently, the benefits of getting an education have never attracted black folk like it attracts everybody else.
And I have a rather explosive question to ask you. You touch on it, but I wanna ask you this way. As we think about it, I do not know of a population of people that have been so taught to hate who they are and from whence they came as African American, as blacks. I'm going to use your term.
Okay.
Native blacks.
Right.
So there is hatred and distrust within the community. There is hatred of blacks, as an observer, more so than any other population of people by large societies of people around the world. Now, there are a lot of reasons that hatred is generated in part because of how the culture is exported, mm-hmm. how blacks are seen through in so many negative ways through culture. So we observe all of that, but I'm asking you, the PhD, is for you to weigh in on why there is such hatred towards black people.
Again, a good question. There are about four basic reasons why they hate black folk, and a lot of it springs from our inappropriate behavior patterns to justify it. The initial reason why the dominant white society and other groups are against black folk is because in their culture in Europe, that black folk typified just the opposite of them. When people look in the mirror, people always loves that which is closest to them, rock. And white folk looked in the mirror and says, we are whites and they are blacks in color. So therefore, what am I gonna love? They're gonna love themselves first. And they love, therefore whiteness became to symbolize goodness, fairness, angelical, honesty, everything you name, mm-hmm. something that's valued. Mm-hmm. They valued white skin because they had white skin. Blacks, on the other hand, signify things just the opposite. Things of evil, dirty, obvious, devilish, foolish, and ignorant. And so that was the first thing that began on black folk. The second thing that began to handicap black folk is once they enslaved black folk, they branded them. Slavery branded black folk because in those European countries, in the Asian countries, they had codes of conduct that says anytime somebody offends you, or your family, you got an obligation to defend yourself and fight. And in Europe and in Asia, they had what's called dueling, where you got out with the swords and dueling and fought it out. Mm-hmm. Or in the United States, in the West, they had shootouts, cowboys going out in gunfights because you offended them. But see, in black folk never defended themselves. And what whites said in their psyche is there's no honor in being a slave. There's nothing, and so consequently, if you allow us, anybody else, to enslave you for 460 years, we have no respect for you, no appreciation for you, we don't value you. And the last thing they did was say that now is that because you let us do this to you, we hate you because you're weak people. You spend all your time trying to get along with us. There was a white doctor in about 1850 says, in one speech, he says, he says, don't ever worry about black folk. They'll never come after you or take up arms against you. All they want to do is be at their beck and call, to be a hand servant, to wait on us, to help us, to comfort us.
The most forgiving people on earth.
Most forgiving person on earth. He says you're always forgiving, compromising, acquiescing, and going on kissing on people, trying to get along with them, and being acceptable. And that's what happened with the whole civil rights movement. And so now when these civil rights leaders always want to beg and march and demonstrate and say, just please accept us. Let us come into your home, come to your school, your neighborhood. White said, we don't have any respect for you. And one of my friends from the Bay of Pigs, hero in Miami, he told me the same thing. He said, the reason, as a Hispanic, the reason we don't like to be around you is because you beg all the time. You never demand anything. And there was a white Asian writer for a newspaper in San Francisco. He told me the same thing. He said, Dr. Anderson, I hate black folk. He said, not because of who they are. As a person, I hate them because of their attitude, their behavior. He said, why in the world they keep begging people? Why do they keep begging people to get along with them rather than sit down and say, no, I'm not gonna do that and demand rights and respect? He said, I don't like black folk. And I agreed. I said, you know what? You're right. Slavery would have ended, Rock. Slavery would not have lasted 1 month back in the 15th and 16th century if black folks said, I'm not going to do it. I'm not going for it. You can kill me if you want. That's fine. You lose money because you bought me. But I tell you, but if you try to enslave me, rob and rape me, and steal my kids and deny me the resources and have a decent quality of life and my humanity for 3 or 4 or 6 years, I'll die first and I'll take you with me and your mama and your kids and your house and everything else and your dog. But see, black folk never stood up. And the worst part about it, and none of the African countries in all this 400 years of slavery and Jim Crow segregation, the African country, that's why I said don't call blacks African Americans. They did not send not one boat. They did not send one boat to America to rescue or to the Caribbean 15 to 16 million who had been enslaved and mistreated and slaughtered. Didn't sail one boat.
We sit here on the campus of Howard University in Washington, D.C., and you speak in your book about the unique and special history of between blacks and the District of Columbia. Tell us about that.
Well, this the District of Columbia throughout history was always one of the big slave capitals. And all around all these buildings around here. See, black folk built all the buildings in the first place. They were the labor that built all the major business buildings. But they used to have slave auctions right on the White House lawn and down the streets of Roby House, the biggest slave quarters, and over in Virginia where they were selling slaves. Washington, D.C. was a slave capital, okay? That's the first thing. The second thing was that in Washington, D.C. was the home of first blacks even enslaved in the Capitol. They were in the White House as servants. And so over a period of time now, too, with slavery, Washington, at one point I'm trying to pull up on it, Washington also was used and never used to, ask me that question again because something slipped out of my mind.
No, just the special relationship between blacks and the District of Columbia.
Right, and see right now, and when I came to Washington, D.C. as an example, show you the difference. When I came to Washington with President Carter, back in 1970s. At that particular time, it had been as it was all the way through slavery. I told you during the slavery period. Mm-hmm. Washington was called Chocolate City. Mm-hmm. It was the chocolate city of the nation. Mm-hmm. And at that point in time, the city was 78% black.
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
78% black, and now it's down to like 42 or 43%. Mm-hmm. And because you got immigrants and you got gentrification, where whites are coming back, taking over the city, you got privatization of the property, and so black folk has shrunk now from 78% down to about 42, 43%. Look what happened now. As they shrunk down, black folk now moved out of the city, moved to PG County. And in the city now, if I look at the wealth level of blacks in the city of Washington, D.C., since it's been privatized and gentrified, the average wealth, again, wealth is a key for survival. The average wealth of a white person living in Washington, D.C. is about $235,000. Mm-hmm. But the average wealth base for a black living in D.C. is $3,500. Because you're down to chicken change. Because black folks still confuse income with wealth. That's a difference. Mm-hmm. That's a major difference. You go over to PG County, all those blacks that left Washington sold their houses for chicken change and went to PG County. Look at what happened over there.
Yeah.
Over there, that you have the highest concentration of educated blacks in America living in PG County. You have the highest concentration of wealthy blacks in the United States living in PG County.
Yeah.
I go to PG County, guess who's gonna run all the businesses and all the stores? Immigrants. Yeah. And over there, the Hispanics who've been here less than 35 years now got five times the wealth base of blacks in PG County, where you got the highest concentration of blacks in the United States and
educated
wealth.
Educated too.
Educated.
Yeah.
And they're still on the bottom.
Yeah. Let's get into a little bit, and then we will probably jump back also. But in terms of now the policies that are coming out of this government regarding, you talk about, for example, there's several things, but let's just deal with health care.
Well, health care, there's a direct link between having health care, having good health, and having money. That's the biggest connection.
Mm-hmm.
I know for about 6 or 7 straight years, Wayne State University Medical School in Detroit used to invite me to come in to be the keynote speaker for the health convention. I said, I'm not a medical doctor. Mm-hmm. They said, yeah, but Dr. Anderson, you're the only person in this country that speaks and relate wealth to having good health.
Mm-hmm.
They said most of these blacks in the country who can't afford insurance, can't afford proper Medicare, can't afford proper food, you say that if you don't have the money, you're gonna suffer.
Yeah.
And he said, you're the only person used to tell us you got to have the wealth and the power and to be able to afford the necessary things you have to have a comfortable life and a healthy lifestyle. And I said, that's right. So I was a keynote speaker for them for years. And right now, if you got a poverty rate in the United States, where 38% of the black folk are beneath the poverty line, 36% of all the black children are beneath the poverty line, how do you expect them to be healthy? How do you expect them to, who's going to take care of them for the diseases, everything else, physical injuries? And so they don't have the base to do it. Nobody makes the issue out of it.
Yeah.
And so consequently, you cannot have a healthy body and a healthy mind when you have no money and resources to do it.
Describe your thoughts, your feelings about the presidency of Barack Obama as it relates to black Americans. And we were just talking about health care there. Was sort of one of his signature initiatives, the Affordable Care Act, was that something that was foundationally correct to help, obviously, everybody in the country, but especially blacks who could perhaps benefit from universal health care? Or is establishing that another form of what you described earlier as black folks begging?
Yeah, I'm not that vested into knowing all the intricacies of his healthcare program. I stayed away from that.
Mm.
But he could have done some other things that could have balanced that out. Mm. If he had focused on trying what Martin Luther King should have focused on, redistributing some resources into black folks' hands,
mm-hmm.
so they can begin to acquire a better lifestyle. And that's the problem. See,
mm-hmm.
it's not civil rights, it's not social integration that mm-hmm. determines the quality of life.
Mm-hmm.
And because, see, right now, it's what you own and control. Black folk who own and control 0.5%, they haven't got a snowball's chance of getting any insurance or getting anything else that's quality-based.
I have a good friend whose mantra is what he says that King's position was towards the latter part of his life, and that is proportional economics.
He started getting into that right before he got assassinated,
yeah.
About 3 or 4 months. Martin Luther said, I've come to learn that after 10 years, they cannot have real true social integration unless you have economic integration. And you cannot have economic integration unless you go back and redistribute some of the wealth, resources, and opportunities into the hands of black folk.
Mm-hmm.
But he said that, unfortunately, he said, I've learned that, but it's a little late then. But he spent 10 years pushing everybody's wagon, pushing diversity, multicultural, and taking care of the world, and for blacks to be altruistic and to subject themselves to abuses, to take physical abuse, and rather than saying, no, we don't need to go back and rebuild these black communities and give them more resources.
So we've got about 10 minutes left, man. That's how fast this time has gone by. Let's start to discuss. What you've just described is a deep, dark hole.
That it is.
Unfortunately, I think it would be difficult for anyone to argue with some of your analysis here. Much of what you're talking about is rooted in obvious reality. Given that that's the case, let's please start to, we can't leave here without some hope, you know, to start thinking about what you, as such a veteran observer, economist, someone who has paid attention to this arc. Let's start talking about some solutions.
Oh, I love that. That's my favorite thing. And the solution, there are several things you can do very quickly. First of all, black folk need understanding what you're saying, that they are in a deep, dark hole. Okay, and they're locked in that deep, dark hole by some institutions. The first institution is the United States Constitution. Mm-hmm. That's got them locked in box. Mm-hmm. And nobody's ever raised any issue about the United States Constitution.
And so I'm going to ask you, because you talk about it in the book. They ain't got to buy your book. They made me go to the library. But they need to read your book, man. This book needs to be read, people. So you talk about the Constitution a little
right.
bit. You talk a little bit about the dark side.
Right.
Give us a little bit of that, and then we want to come back and talk to about solutions.
Okay, good. And see, the dark side, the Constitution was written to be the first affirmative action plan in the entire United States.
Mm-hmm.
But nobody understands that. It's an affirmative action plan for whites,
mm-hmm.
okay?
Mm-hmm.
And what they're saying is that these people, and we're going to make sure these people are locked in box. And so we're going to build this Constitution based on two things.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to use a mm-hmm. whole body of people mm-hmm. to enrich us, to bring comfort to us, And at the same time, we're going to talk about everybody having equal opportunity, being the land of freedom. Right. But, but we're going to shut these people down. They're not going to have any freedom.
Yeah.
And so before they drew the Constitution up in 17.
Hold it. Because you know, there's just something there that just like, boom, you know.
Okay.
And because that's like, in the, you know, to use the language of Don King, mm-hmm. the boxing promoter, that's the original trickeration.
That's right. That's
the original trick.
That's it. And the Constitution is a base upon all these, whatever the decision was based, it was based on trickery. Because what they did, they set it up so they met in Philadelphia in 1789. They met there and said, here's what we're going to do. We're going to start writing this Constitution. And what we're going to do, but how do we justify bringing all these people here looking for free land and free Indian land and free black labor to get honor and benefits? At the same time, we're going to talk about that all people have a right to life, liberty, and pursuit. And they said, initially it said property. Yeah. But Thomas Jefferson said, we can't say property. Mm-hmm. Let's go back into the Constitution and rewrite it and say happiness.
Yeah.
See, because so they saw bamboozled and said, nobody's coming across the country, world, coming around the world just to look for happiness in America. They were coming to look for free honor and benefits.
Yeah.
So what they said, well, here's the trick we're going to do. We're going to write this document. They spent a whole week with the doors locked and the shutters drawn. See, how do we write a Constitution that's gonna lock blacks in and nobody to recognize it? So what they said, here's what we do in the Constitution. Let's use coded language. They said that one coded language for whites and a coded language to talk about black folk. Mm-hmm. And so in the Constitution, we talk about all people. They're talking about whites. Mm-hmm. We say citizens. They're talking about whites. When they say so they use those kind of language and the people. When they say the people, they're talking about whites. Blacks were property. Mm-hmm. So when the Constitution says the people, all the people, they're talking about whites. Mm-hmm. Blacks are property, and they're classified as equal to an animal. So when you talk about in the Constitution, look at it and you read it. It says when you talk about black folk, it says those who are in bondage, those who are indebted, those who have specific property, that specific group of people, those who are unhappily lot. They're talking about black folks. Yeah. They use it, and they say always use coded language, and bring it up to date right quick so I can get off this point. I know the time is running out. Right. See, Ronald Reagan told the country the same thing when he came into office in 82.
Yeah. Yeah.
See, when I left the White House with President Carter, with his administration, when Reagan came in, one of the first things he did, he called Haldeman into the office and said, when you start talking about black issues in America, make sure you use coded language.
Yeah.
He said, never say anything specifically, solely, directly against black. Mm-hmm. He said, what you do is use a very broad, ambiguous language. He says, and the jigs.
Yeah, welfare queens.
Yeah, the jigs, they'll never know what you're talking about. Mm-hmm. Use very broad words like minority, poor folk, people of color. Yeah. That way they never know, they ain't gonna get a darn thing out of it. Mm-hmm. We can hide it. Mm-hmm. So they use hidden codes to be able, in the Constitution, to define what whites would get and what immigrants would get and nothing that blacks were gonna get, okay? That coding is still being used today to talk about diversity, multicultural, people of color.
Yeah.
They're saying, let's pretend that black folk don't exist. And no public policy is gonna say specifically for black folk, nothing gonna address them. And that's when not one president in the United States, including Obama, has ever done anything specifically and solely to address the needs of black folk. Not one politician. As soon as a politician goes and gets in office, even if he's black, first thing you say is that I gotta represent all the people. Mm-hmm. I gotta represent everybody. I can't do anything for black folk, but I can do things for Jews, Arabs, Asians, Hispanics, midgets, handicapped, transgenders, anything, but I can never do anything for black folk. So what that does is freezes black folk in the lowest level of a real life monopoly game.
And so now let's talk about some solutions.
Okay, now the solution, the first thing I would tell black folk do is understand, declare yourself to be a native people, native blacks. You're the oldest population here, point two. And then and declare your exceptionality. Say that you're entitled to things that have never been given to you, that you're exceptional people and you've been mistreated and maltreated. And because of that, don't include me in these very broad ambiguous groups. Get out of affirmative action. I have the dubious honor of writing the first affirmative action plan in the United States in 1970-71 for the state of Florida. I wrote that plan not for minorities, I wrote it for black folk, but it was diluted and watered down and corrupted about 6 or 7 months after I wrote it and went all over the country, saying it was for affirmative action for all people. Mm-hmm. And so I want blacks to get out of affirmative action and go for reparations.
I was getting ready to say that very clearly.
That's right.
You're saying affirmative action, get away from that.
Get away from
it. Start talking specifically, succinctly about reparations.
That's right. And put your own self-interest first. Quit trying to be altruistic and trying to represent everybody. Every time there's a march for anybody, you out there marching, leading the parade, you start saying, no, I'm gonna put my interest first. Because, and understand that God sent you here black, blackness is your badge of honor, it's your exceptionality, it's your course to get out of this problem. Then what you do then, you say, I want to also rebuild my own communities. Go back and rebuild your own communities. Rebuild your own, and in those communities, do what you had before the 1960s. Rebuild, you put your own businesses in there. So and right now, we do not have not one single community in America. All we got are black neighborhoods, and everybody else got communities. You cannot rock, be a competitive group with neighborhoods. You got to have communities. And every group coming to America, the first thing they do in the West Coast, the Japanese, Asian, Arabs, anybody, they say, first thing we're going to do is build communities. We're going to find somebody to look like us, build us a community. So you got Arab towns, Korea towns, Chinatowns, Japan towns, Little Saigons, you got Little Havanas, Little Hialeahs, you got Little Italy, you got Greek towns, Pole towns, Hocket towns, any kind of, but you never find a black town because we are integrated. And integration means you scattered and lost your power and your resources. Mm-hmm. And so, and you cannot run a business with scattered resources. It can't be done. So you build your own communities, and a community is where you store your value, your culture, your history, your tax base, your jobs, and your employment opportunities. You store them in your own communities. That's why 98% of all these other groups, they have their own communities, spend their money with their own people. We got it backwards. We spend our, we go to other people's community, we go to other people's jobs to help them. And only 2% of the blacks in America work in their own community, in their own neighborhoods for their own people and got jobs. And so you got to build these communities, then you start practicing group economics and group politics. You pull out all the parties, build your own black independent parties, move away from the Republican Party, pull out of the Democratic Party, because neither one of them have your interests at heart, and create your own parties, but don't run any candidates. So we will vote for any candidate in the National Black Independent Party who will promise the most and deliver resources to black folk to correct this structural inequity we're into. And I go through politics, show you how to play the politics. Keep your money with your own people, hire your own people, practice group economics from the bottom to the top.
You know, man, so if we were to go back 50 or 60 years and look at how mainstream media portrayed the emergence of Martin Luther King, you know, they sanitized him as best they could and turned him into the dreamer. You have given some voice to that, perhaps, you know, that there should have been a much greater focus on economic interest.
That's right.
Than there was
in social.
Social and integration. And if you look at, though, as to how he became sort of to emerge as a darling of the media, the dreamer, if you will, and you look at the same time, someone who was attempting to do what you're talking about then, you look at Elijah Muhammad, and you look at how he was vilified as a lunatic if we play make-believe here just for a moment. If you talk about the policies, the strategy of Elijah Muhammad to say, do for yourself and build your own communities. And if we had now 50 or 60 years of that versus this piece, the integration piece, which is so diluted, man, it's just difficult not to look back at it and say, what if?
Yes, if you should say that throughout history. The question would be not only with that, the question would be, what would America look like right now if you never had blacks in here as slaves? What would America look like today if you didn't have them to build the roads, pick the cotton, to build it? They were the people they were the engines that drove the economic development of this country. Yeah. What would this country look like if blacks, they never could have done it? There's no way this country could have ever been built without the black slaves be doing it for them. And so
so just on that point right there, on that point right there, if one is to say that that's a valid point, then there should be a straight line with anything, entity, person or otherwise, that talks about equality. There's a straight line then to reparation. If that's the case, then there should be a straight line to reparation.
There should be a straight, but see, but what happens is that you got in the social order, that social construct, that there is pushback against anything, because see, the dominant society and all those subcategories of ethnic groups, they don't want you to do that, because right now all the ethnic groups, the white dominant white society, the Hispanics, Arabs, and Asians, they're living off of two incomes. They're living off of 100% of their own money because they keep it confined to their communities. It doesn't go to blacks, and they live off of 98% of blacks' money. So every group in this country lives off of double incomes. Yeah. 198% blacks have forced to live off of 2%. So that they can't make it. Because they're spending their money in stores and businesses that don't belong to them. And so the issue and the conclusion is that the issue I'm saying to you is not hating anybody.
Mm-hmm.
See, black folk, I'm not against any immigrants. Mm-hmm. What I'm against is that is the racist immigration policies that have kept black folk locked in box outside the system mm-hmm. for 460 years. And for black folk, got to learn how to compete. And the other problem they got is that they got to understand that once they start trying to compete, the dominant white society is going to push back because they say, you're taking money out of my pocket.
Mm-hmm.
I got 198% now. And you only got two.
Right.
And so I'm opposed to your chain begging about any change.
Power concedes nothing without a struggle, never
That's
has,
right.
never will.
That's right. And power has no feelings about morality mm-hmm. or justice.
Mm-hmm.
I see black folk march street talk. We're marching for justice. Power doesn't care about justice. Mm-hmm. It doesn't care about morality.
Mm-hmm.
It can talk about who owns and controls the resources. Yeah. And the last thing I'm saying to you in conclusion is that you don't get any pushback from the dominant white society. I mean, from the black overclass is because 98% of them have already received meritorious manumission.
Mm-hmm.
They've already been set free. They're getting benefits, mm-hmm. what they call performance-based income.
Yeah.
And they're scared to death to do anything that might align them with black folk in the country.
As Dick Gregory would say, the struggle continues.
That's right.
Thank you so much for being here. This is the fastest hour in television.
Thank you, folks.
That wraps us for this evening. For more information on this program, or any other program produced by WHUT, go to WHUT.org. Goodbye, and God bless, and keep the faith.
This program was produced by WHUT, Howard University Television, and made possible by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.